हेलो एवरीवन, माय सेल्फ नम्रता ठाकुर, सीनियर लेक्चरर इन द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ कंप्यूटर इंजीनियरिंग एट प्रवीण पाटिल पॉलिटेक्निक भाईंदर इज। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू लर्न द सेकेंड पार्ट ऑफ द थर्ड चैप्टर प्रोसेस मैनेजमेंट। आई हैव ऑलरेडी अपलोडेड द फर्स्ट पार्ट, पार्ट वन। काइंडली गो थ्रू इट टू रिवाइज योर कंसेप्ट। सो लेट्स स्टार्ट विद द पार्ट टू। फ्रॉम दिस एंटायर वीडियो द स्टूडेंट विल एबल टू अंडरस्टैंड the concept of process scheduling, the different types of scheduling queues, the concept of scheduler along with its type, and get concluded with the concept of IPC. So student, let's start with this each and every concept in detail. The first one is process scheduling. Process scheduling means you are doing the scheduling of the process. You are in the sense your OS is doing the scheduling of the process. What exactly the scheduling is? Student, do you have your own schedule in this lockdown? Yes, of course. Yes, you have. You're getting early in the morning, you're taking breakfast, you're taking bath. After that, you're attending the lecture, you're doing the submission of assignments and the quiz. And after that, the rest of the time, you're doing the other activities. So you are arranging this activity as per your choice. That means you are giving the time to this particular activity. Why you are doing the same? To save your time as well as to do everything in a proper manner. Similar way, my OS is also arranging all the processes in the proper order or as per the priority. This is called as a process scheduling. Why OS is doing that? So as to keep the CPU always busy and to get the maximum response or the output. The next concept is scheduling queue. The scheduling queue is a queue where all the processes inside the computer system get stored. Student, for example, I am having 20 processes inside my computer system. So all that 20 processes get stored in one queue, and that queue is called as a scheduling queue. A scheduling queue is responsible for storing or arranging the processes in a proper manner. There are three types of queue. First one is a job queue, second one is a ready queue, and third one is a device queue. And from these queues, process scheduler is one who select the processes for the execution. For example, 20 processes are there, and out of which the 18th has to be executed. So my process scheduler will select this process for the execution. Let's see what do you mean by job queue, ready queue, and after that the device queue. So what do you mean by that? First one is a job queue. Job queue is responsible for storing all the processes inside your computer system. For example, 20 processes are there. So in job queue, all 20 processes get stored. But in case of ready queue, out of 20, if 5 processes are ready for the execution, if opportunity is given to it, that 5 processes will get stored in the ready queue. Out of 20, again 10 processes are waiting for some input output device. So that processes will get stored in a device queue. So job queue store all the processes, ready queue store the processes which are ready for the execution, and device queue will store the processes which are waiting for the input output devices. Here I am showing you the representation of scheduler queue. Here the rectangle is showing the queue, whereas the circle is showing the processes. Therefore, see here, whenever the process enters into the system, it will enter into the job queue. From job queue, it will move to the ready queue. From the ready queue, if that particular process get the CPU, it will execute it and it will enter into the exit state. This is the normal flow. From job queue, the process enters into the ready queue. If it gets the CPU, it will perform the task and it will move into the exit state. But while the execution is going on, if some interrupt occur, then it will again move to the ready queue. Similar way, if the time period expires, suppose I have given 10 milliseconds for process to execute and that 10 minute gets over, what will happen? The process again will move into the ready queue. Whenever the execution is going on, if my process is creating a new child, if it is forking a new child, again it will move into the ready queue. And if the particular process wants some input output device, that will get stored into the IO queue and again into the ready queue. So this is all about the representation of process scheduling. The next one is a scheduler. As I said before, scheduling queue is responsible for storing all the processes, and from that queue, the scheduler will select the process to execute. It is used to select the process from the scheduling queue for the execution. There are three types of scheduler. First one is a LTS, second one is a STS, and third one is MTS. That is long-term scheduler, short-term scheduler, and medium-term scheduler. Let's see what do you mean by long-term scheduler and short-term scheduler as well as medium-term scheduler. Your LTS, that is long-term scheduler. We have discussed something about of job queue. Job queue means what, students? The queue we store all the processes. So from that job queue, we have to select a process for the execution. Therefore LTS is storing, or LTS is selecting, or I can say that LTS is transferring the processes from the job queue to the ready queue. All 20 processes in the job queues are there. So my long-term scheduler will select the processes from the job queue to the ready queue. Next one is a STS. STS selects the processes from the ready queue. Here, long-term scheduler basically select the processes which should be brought into the ready queue. In STS, the process STS select the processes from the ready queue to execute. And the medium-term scheduler is required whenever the interrupt occurs. At that time, swapping is done. So, swapping means the processes are moving in and out from the memory. So in case of swapping, the medium term scheduler is used. I am giving you the detailed explanation of LTS, STS and MTS through this diagram. As I said, job queue is responsible for storing all the processes. So here, if the job queue is present, so from job queue, my LTS is present over here. Here my LTS is there. LTS will brought the processes from the job queue to the ready queue. Job queue se ready queue mein lane ka kaam is doing by the LTS. Now, in case of STS, STS is present over here. The processes which are stored in the ready queue, here my STS select the processes from the ready queue and it will allocate the CPU to it. So STS is responsible for selecting the processes from the ready queue. And medium term scheduler, whenever the interrupt occurs, at that time swapping is done. So to perform the swapping, we are using the MTS scheduler. This is all about the scheduler. So let's see the difference between LTS and MTS. As I said, LTS is responsible for bringing the processes from the job queue to the ready queue. Which process should be brought into the ready queue, that is done by the LTS. It is also called as a job scheduler. whereas STS, which is called as a CPU scheduler, which is responsible for selecting the processes from the ready queue for the execution. The frequency of the execution in LTS is less, whereas the frequency of execution in STS is more. Why? Because STS select the processes which are ready for the execution. If processes are ready for the execute, then there is no question whether they got executed or not. Therefore, frequency of execution is more. LTS takes more time, whereas STS takes less time. In most of the system, LTS is not present because it is not required. All the processes from the job queue will move to the ready queue automatically, and from the actually STS is necessary to select the processes. Therefore, STS is necessary. We are showing it with the help of diagram. Here LTS is present, and here STS is present. Now, the next part is the IPC, that is inter-process communication. Student, this whole chapter is about the process management. That is, what are the different activities related to the processes? In first video, we have seen the process, different state of the process, context switching. Here in this video, we have already seen the scheduling, scheduler. Now we are moving how exactly the processes are communicated with each other. Whenever the processes are communicated with each other, it is called as a inter-process communication. Inter-process communication is a IPC. So IPC stands for inter-process communication, communication between two processes. What exactly you mean by communication? What do you mean by communication? But obvious, whenever the two processes are sharing the data, transferring the data with each other, it is called as a inter-process communication. And inter-process communication, there is no magic in this case. Process will directly get communicated or directly transfer the data with each other. There are two models for the same. First one is a shared memory, and second one is a message passing. Student, but IPC happens only for cooperating processes. So the question will comes in your mind, what do you mean by cooperating process? First of all, we will see two types of process. First one is an independent process, and second one is a cooperating process. Independent process means what? The process which are not depend on any other process, that are not required, that process not required any data from the other process. So that process comes under the category of independent process. See, as I have written over here, it does not share the data with other, or it can't affect the other process and not affected by the other process, and is not going to share any data with each other, with other process. Therefore, IPC mechanism is not required for independent process, because IPC is inter-process communication, and it is required for transferring the data between two or more process. Whereas your cooperating process is the processes which share the data with each other, or which affect the other process and get affected by the other process. So whenever your process is sharing the data with each other, or the process which is depending upon another, that is called as a cooperating process. Therefore, the process which share the data with each other and which affect the other process or get affected by the other process, that comes under the category of cooperating process. And your IPC is always required for the cooperating process. What is the need, or what are the advantages of this IPC mechanism? If I am saying that IPC is required for the communication purpose, what is the use of it? But obvious, for the information sharing. If I am transferring the data with the help of IPC mechanism, then it is used for information sharing. If I am sharing something, that means the computation speed get increases. Modularity, it will divide the task into different modules, and it is easy to use. Therefore, these are the advantages or need of cooperating process. As I have written in the first slide of IPC, there are two ways to do the IPC. If I am saying that processes are communicating with each other, processes are transferring the data with each other, it requires some mechanism. And that mechanism is the fundamental model of IPC. There are two models. First one is a shared memory and second one is message passing. In case of shared memory, student take example of two process P1 and P2. They want to share the data with each other. In case of shared memory, as shown in this figure, one sharing region get established and all the data inside your computer system get loaded in that shared region. So in shared region, all the data which is get shared is get loaded and the process access that data to transfer the information. So sharing region is established, processes share data through this region and the region resides in the address space of the program. So this is all about the shared memory. One region called as a shared region get established. All the processes who want data will contact to that shared region and it will transfer the data or it will take or get the data from that shared region. Now, when this shared region is useful, the shared region is useful when large amount of data to be transferred. Suppose I want to transfer large amount of data, I will put that data into that particular shared region. For example, your Google Drive. You're sharing your Google Drive, you're sharing that link. That means what? You're uploading data over there. This is a common region where anyone can access that data. It is useful for maximum speed, faster than the message passing. Rather than transferring the data with the help of messages, you're using the shared region. So it is faster than message passing. And one system call is used to set up the memory region. The next model is message passing. In shared memory, we are using the shared region concept where the data get transferred through the shared region. But in case of message passing, the process are communicating by sending and receiving the message. So data is exchanged with the help of message. Suppose there are two processes, P1 and P2. Both want to transfer the data. What will they do? They will transfer the data with the help of messages. So there is no need of such shared region or shared address space. They are using two operations, send and receive. As shown in this figure, whenever the process want to share the data, it will use two operations. First one is send and second one is a receive. This is the most familiar to you as you are always using the chat operation. In chat also, you are using the operation called as a send and receive. So whenever a small amount of data to be transferred, this model is very useful. It is useful for maximum speed This is useful for exchanging the small amount of data. It is easier than timeshare model because you don't have to access anything. You just type the message and send it. It is slower and the system call is also required called as a send and receive for the message passing. Thank you everyone. If you have any doubt, let me know. I will surely help you for the same. Post your doubts in your comment box. Thank you.